guest speaker, member, Dr. Christina Kostoula. Been very much looking forward to her talk. Thank you. On Soviet ballet, dance, the classical legacy of humanism. So over to Christina.
Apart from its demands for bread, peace and land, the October Revolution made demands for culture, not for the selected few, the culture for the elite, but for the whole of the people who were and still are thirsty for art and education. The foundations for creating a new proletarian culture were laid then and there. According to Lenin's vision, the new culture would need to appropriate all the important achievements of bourgeois civilization and build on them. Lenin stressed the importance of building on the past rather than attempting artificially to create something new. Like Marx, who based his work on the knowledge acquired by humanity under the capitalist system. Proletarian culture is not to be clutched out of thin air. It is not the invention of those who call themselves experts in proletarian culture. It was a logical development of the store of knowledge mankind has accumulated and which was to be assimilated first and then built upon. One must acquire first that sum of knowledge of which communism itself is the result. It should therefore come as no surprise that when we're talking about building on solid foundation, that the classical art form such as ballet served as a base for what Lenin envisaged as the development of the best models, traditions, and results of the existing culture from the point of view of the Marxist world outlook. And ballet was a great, already greatly developed tradition in Russia for at least 1.5 centuries before the Russian Revolution. According to the Marxist-Leninist point of view, every artist has the right to create freely. But as a Marxist-Leninist, we have to consider what constitutes this freedom in the capitalist world. There is this question that concerns a lot of people that I have met in the art world as to whether the artists were feeling free or restricted, constrained by the rules, especially during the Stalin years. So the first question that I tend to ask them is what they consider freedom, and if they are free to create in the world that they live today. So I'm basically questioning the class freedom of a bourgeois artist. And Lenin has written about this as being a false and limited idea of a freedom, of artistic freedom, as opposed to what artistic freedom could really be, the truly free socialist creation. Freedom in art is the freedom, I quote Lenin, to elevate the masses, teach them, and strengthen them. So ballet was taken away from the little autocratic caste that had owned it in the past till then, and was given back to the people, became for the people. This is the facade of the Bolshoi Theater, a cradle of classic ballet tradition, still to today, adorned with the portraits of Marx, Engels, Lenin, and Stalin, celebrating the October Revolution back in 1937. And this is a rare photo of a class of ballet taking place during the siege of Leningrad. So ballet, in a sense, represented the achievements, the cultural achievements, the art, the humanism that the Bolsheviks had attained, that this society had every reason to defend against fascism, and I think gets captured in this photograph. Ballet for the people, by the people. I'll stay with this. Lenin called revolutions the festivals of the oppressed and the exploited. So the moment of effervescence that I described as the Russian Revolution, this impetus of the people, it needs to be organized. The creative instincts of the masses need to be organized. We were talking about education. From spontaneity of feeling, that is a great point of departure, If it stays there, it remains empty. If it does not transcend to a consciousness of class and a consciousness of struggle. So a lot of artists who actually talk about emotions, feelings, spontaneity, if they don't use this to transcend them to a consciousness of their existence, that remains something empty. So that movement from spontaneous being to conscious class existence is what defined dance as all art forms with a social mission in the Soviet Union. Art that is created by and reflects back the reality of the struggle for socialism. It is art with a name. So ballet became an art with a name. The lack of aim could reduce any form of dance into a spontaneous, naturalistic, instinctive impulse. But here we're talking about using an already highly organized form of movement for a social aim, so beyond the naturalistic, something that inspires and gets inspired by the vision of a socialist society. So this is what Soviet ballet is. So the idea of social realism is very important to explore, because ballet, as all art forms, since the Russian Revolution, but especially during the 30s and 40s, had to be and was for the people and by the people, expressing the reality of the people in their struggle for a socialist society. So socialist realism in itself is a movement, an effort, a struggle in order to proceed towards the socialist future. And the socialist realist art can materialize in different ways, and it did materialize in different creative endeavors in all art forms, from painting, theater, and dance, indeed dance. The early 1930s was the dawn of socialist realism. That doesn't mean that as a concept it didn't exist before, but it became part of policy and became part of an artist's education. It is a very grand concept, I believe, of humanist effort, the effort for art to correspond to the needs of the people, to provide affirmation for the universal historic mission of the working class. Lunacharsky wrote that in the figure of Maxim Gorky, who was the great theorist of socialist realism and laid the foundations for socialist realism, the working class had found its artistic identity. As in Marx, Engels, and Lenin, they found their philosophical and political identity. Gorky, addressing the Congress in Defense of Culture in 1935 in Paris, he said, "There is only one class in the world that is capable of understanding and sympathizing with the universal significance of humanism. That class is the proletariat. Our efforts as artists should be dedicated to the work of releasing the inexhaustible reserves of intellectual energy latent in the hundreds of millions of working people, the handing workers of culture, the working intellectuals, and the laboring peasants who want to be and deserve to be masters of culture." So we're not really talking about an enclave of specialists, but an art form that should open up to the people so that they become masters of culture. So the task for the new Soviet ballet artists, engineers of the soul, as Stalin called artists, was to find themes which would reflect the lives of the people, the philosophy and social reality, and at the same time attain a dance lexicon which would harmonize mime, which is part of ballet, and pure dance. Pure dance is dance that doesn't necessarily have a meaning. And at the same time being able to interpret the themes. So that was the task that they had. In 1935, Pravda published the following: "Soviet art must inspire the masses in their struggle for a full and final victory of socialism. It must help them in this struggle. The era of the struggle for communism must become the era of socialist renaissance in art, for only socialism creates the conditions for a complete flourishing of all national talents. And this, what was written in Pravda, affected ballet greatly. In the same year, this great dance educator, Agrippina Vaganova, the greatest ballet teacher, who wrote many studies on ballet, on ballet education, and she's the matriarch of the ballet world within Russia, within the Soviet Union at the time, but even today, if you train to become a ballet teacher, you have to read Agrippina Vaganova. And she wrote in the same year, 1935, that she wrote in Zvestia, she was back then artistic director of the Kirov Ballet. She wrote one production after the other, after another, Swan Lake, The Flames of Paris, The Fountain of Baksisarai, Esmeralda, every new role danced by virtuoso artists of classical dance, all attest ever more insistently and clearly to the birth of a popular, narodny, of the people, realistic ballet theater. So she got inspired, even though, you know, what wouldn't think of her as a communist, she, as a ballet educator, had to take into account the mission of the arts within the society that she lived in and find a way to create, based on what she knew, a form that would belong to the people. So how would she achieve that? Through her role as artistic director, but also in her pedagogy, how to make these principles of ballet movement accessible, to systematize them so it's not down to individual teaching geniuses to teach them, but to systematize them in the way that ballet could be taught everywhere to everyone. So she had to be self-critical. She had to really investigate the knowledge that was passed down to her, write it down, popularize it, and make it scientific. So from something that is spontaneous and down to talent, Vaganova systematized in a way that could be communicated. And that created a whole generation of ballet dancers who thought of her art as something scientific. And of course, they could teach it to kids who would never be exposed to ballet in the world before the revolution, in palaces of culture that opened up across the Soviet Union, to children whose parents, you know, belong to the working class. Due to Vaganova's efforts, we have a system that gets propagated everywhere. And it's still the case why there is a certain foundation and excellence in Russian ballet teaching. We owe it to Vaganova. But Vaganova would not have functioned as she did if it wasn't for the society that she lived in and for the demands of socialist realism, the demands for a narodny, for a popular ballet theater. So what happened in the productions? What happened? What was there for the people to watch when they were going to the theater, inspired by socialist realism? It was classicism. It was classical 19th century productions that remained popular. Swan Lake is one that comes into the mind of even someone who is not very very acquainted with the world of ballet. But these classical ballets, who were there in the times of the Tsar, became revisioned. There were numerous revisions, adaptations, and those adaptations were taking the themes from the world of literature. Again, being true to what Lenin said, that we have to use the best that bourgeois tradition has to offer. And especially at that time, it was a time where people drew from their national poets, Pushkin. And these two photographs show Galina Ulanova, the great Soviet ballerina, people's artist, in Baksisarai, in the Fountain of Baksisarai, which is based on a work, on a poem by Pushkin. So that was something that the audience would go to the theater to see, to be exposed to in the 1930s. And of course, they would simultaneously be educated to poetry, to classical history, to different nations, different. It takes place in the Crimea, in the palace of a sultan, of a khan. So there was a lot of historical information that the audience would get from these performances. However, what socialist realist ballet did away with, while keeping those classical traditions, was the mysticism, the magic that surrounded it. That had been very pronounced in the old ballets. It was, for example, in Paris, beginning of the century, you have productions that would use special effects to create this metaphysical feeling. So the ballet dancers were not real workers. You know, they were not. They were sylphs. They were on stage. They would be portrayed as something immaterial and metaphysical. All these traditions that had existed in ballet, the sort of ballet had to do away with, because this dream world did not fit the aim of building a socialist world. So all ballets that were steeped in mysticism were abandoned, and new productions were expurgated from this mysticism. Mysticism, wrote Pushkin, that is everything that is imagined, every delusion, every deceit, the darkness, it's all part of the mysticism. But he says, the darkness of mean truths are dearer to me than elevating frauds. And ballet was an elevating fraud, because it's quite an elevating fraud to portray ballet workers who were poor, had to work like prostitutes to the rich bourgeois audience, to portray them as something so beautiful, so that's something that belongs to the spiritual world, but outside of the stage, a very different reality. So when we look at those artists in those photos, it's not, the emphasis is not on the portrayal of the metaphysical, that people's artists creating culture that helps the people through their bodies. So an elevation of a very different kind, and definitely not a fraud. So, of course, the truths of the Soviet Union were not intended to be mean, but objective. And that means to refer to an external world. And this was the substance of the realistic school of ballet choreographers. What does that mean? I will explain later how it affected subject matter and what was presented, except for the classical works. Since the Cultural Revolution in the 1920s, we have a special interaction between the demands of the recently educated people, the recently empowered working class, peasant readers, and the state's new requirements on cultural producers. So we really have a dialogue between what the people need and what the state provides. And that constitutes real equality between art provision and the audience. And that is what Lenin refers to as the freedom that can be attained by the artist, to have this dialogue with the people. Otherwise, what freedom do we have if we are in a small room doing something elitist that only reaches the few? The Bolshevik artistic policy affected literature, theater, cinema, music, and the fine arts, and established culture as a front where class warfare materializes. So we are moving away from the world of art as something that is that only talks about an imagined world. And we're really talking about warfare, class warfare. What will make the proletarian class stronger in their struggle? The cultural trends of Stalinist policy and the formidable state-backed socialist realism of the 1930s took specific forms using the classical form of ballet. Historically speaking, the way the ballet artist met those needs of state policy was through creating a new genre. So except for the classical ballets, the classicist ballets, we had a genre called drum ballet, standing for dramatic ballet. That was a ballet genre that was meeting the demands of socialist realism. It means that dance tells a story, has a meaning that is accessible, that can be communicated, that is not open to all kinds of interpretation, but it tells a very specific story, that is drum ballet. I read books written at the times, in the 30s and the 40s, about how people in the ballet world defined dramatic ballet. And basically they said dramatic ballet has always been the form of ballet that we did in Russia. And they don't trace it back to the Western influence of the French school of ballet, which is Marius Petipa, who was a French man who went to Russia and established the ballet in the court of the Tsar. But they trace it back to Alexander Gorsky, who was a dramatist, and he worked for the theater, and he collaborated with Stanislavski. And they said really that in the training of an actor and the training of a dancer, there is no distinction in how you tell the story. These distinctions are Western compartmentalization that never applied in the history of Russian performance. So they went back to Gorsky, who wrote in 1890, so long before the revolution, that the artist and the musician, the dramatist and the choreographer, the actor and the producer should serve the same cause. And that is that's long before socialist realism. That is rendering the ideological and artistic content. So they all have this goal, no matter what art form they serve. It was their task to seek jointly for the best way to present the production, so that you already have a name. A specialist in classical dance, as Gorsky was, advanced new principles. His renditions of Don Quixote, I don't know if you've seen the advertisement for this talk online, had a picture of a ballerina I'm going to talk later about dancing the role of a Spanish girl in Don Quixote, which is the Cervantes story, yes? Don Quixote. That, you know, tells a story of written by Cervantes. So Gorsky has the best version, has worked on the best version of Don Quixote that is still on show today on the stage of the Bolshoi. And his renditions of the Don Quixote long before the Russian Revolution were emblematic of the Russian school, of what was achieved in the Russian school in contact with the French ballet school. And he wanted the dancers to leave their parts, so he didn't want just an ornamental use of the body, but he was urging them, and long before Stanislavski, to feel the part. He urged the enhancement of expressive means, so he wanted the dances to be real. And his dances were packed with detail. So socialist realism before socialist realism. And this is where socialist realism really based itself upon, to create a continuation of tradition. So productions packed with detail, with local color. So we have Spanish culture being portrayed, French culture, folk dances from Spain. So we have the aid of the folklore dance. We have the gestures that are not just balletic, but they are instantly recognizable as Spanish. So instead of the neutral port de bras movement that was systematized in the courts. So we have very lively, very real emotional expression, and that is teamed up with the austere sculptural majesty that ballet is known for. So that created a new mix. So we have the ballet, the sculpture and the shapely elements of ballet with the reality of the feeling or of the folk dancing. So this was not in any way restricting the creativity. It was exactly the contrary. Socialist realism became something that enhanced the creativity because it brought elements together. And to have a narrative, to have a plot, it means that you need to serve a story. So you have to enhance your means of saying the story. So the use of dance was not at all pantomimic, which is what you get from Westerners, from Western critics. It was exactly the opposite. Pantomime is dead. It's kind of something ossified. It was something that had to create real living feeling and real emotion. It's a very Stanislavski and very Russian thing, this, that runs through theater and dance in Russia. And so it's the desire to show realistic details of life on the ballet stage. What is the counter argument? They say that ballet is reduced when you do that because dance needs to be partnered not with the story, not with language, but with the music. And that's a very strong argument to make because indeed ballet and dance is dance to music. So, but music doesn't have a message that can be portrayed on stage in the same way that a plot. So people like that tend to support symphonic dance or what is called choreographic symphonism. It's like arranging all the bodies to move as an orchestra to the music. And it's quite abstract. It's the opposite of drum ballet. And after Stalin's death, it's no coincidence that after Stalin's death, all the people who are doing dramatic ballet were pushed to the side as being didactic, as reducing ballet to pantomime, as not allowing for artistic freedom. And the people who were calling for a more complex structure, classical structure, came back. And I find that very interesting and very political, and I wanted to investigate this further. They say that what was lost was this black and white simplicity. They have an issue with simplicity. They think that telling a story and telling it in a simple way that moves the people because it contains real emotion is something simplistic. And ballet should be more complex than that. And that if you tell a story and the aim is to tell the story and to have the message, then ballet loses its specificity. It's not ballet anymore. You're just a socialist realism. You're a communist trying to do something, but you're not a ballet artist. So these arguments after Stalin's death within the choreographic community became more vociferous. And there was a real battle that took place. So we see it in every, it affected every aspect of society, even in the ballet world that we sometimes consider to be a bit apart. So this, the striving after content and the depiction of it, which is the aim in socialist realism, were taken to be a denial of what art is. They said, this is not art. They deny you your role as an artist because you're striving for content. When in fact dance, that's my opinion, does not lose any of its power, it doesn't lose any of its beauty by serving a subject and a message. The contrary, dance in this creative striving becomes enriched and its own traditional canons, like Vaganova showed, evolve and they become systematic and they can live forever like that. The unfolding of content and feeling can only be achieved through movement in ballet. And Soviet ballet excelled in this tradition and still is able to move us today. It is completely erroneous to think that narrative ballets lacked in expressive classical dance and were less innovative. There is this dichotomy that you keep coming across if you read anything on Soviet ballet written in the West, between what they see as free, expressive abstraction, what that is deemed to be superior, to the restrictive narrative of Don Quixote. Just have a story, and that is restrictive, they say. And that is a false dichotomy, and only serves to caricature drum ballet, all the innovation that occurred this time, all the people who worked in it, and of course, the Stalin era. So it was very important for me to really understand where the excellence, where the creative excellence lies into drum ballet. Instead of painting it as something monotonous and feel a bit, okay, yes, my ideology is communist, but ballet didn't do really well back then. The opposite. There is all the research evidence that shows that, and it's not coincidence that these ballets now are getting revived. There is a thirst for people to be moved by a story amongst all this muddled, you know, lack of message. So we are going back and we are rediscovering those ballets in Russia, as it did in the Western world. A lot of drum ballets, like the Fountain of Baksuserai, they get shown in La Scala in Milano. They are in demand. But back then, the Khrushchev years and during the de-Stalinization, there was a huge denial about what happened and what was achieved. They reduced it to something lifeless. They juxtaposed it to something that was meant to restore freedom to the artist. Because some people see the artistry as non-representational. Anything that you can show me, and I know it's recognizable as a flower, is not art. Because it's more persuasive when it is an allegory of human emotion, in a general, what I described, a general mystified metaphysical sense. They prefer that. And by doing that, they deny what poetry exists already in the human body, which is that's what I call humanism of the human body, which is a universalizing power of the human body on stage that is capable to express both the very concrete of the body, the person that you know is a woman, is white, and the historically specific role of this body, and simultaneously that which pertains to humanity and its evolution in general, because it is a human body, you see. Ballet is an art that uses conventionalized aesthetic norms, and it is classical because these norms are at once bound to the physical reality of the person who dances, of the specific human body that dances in the present, but this body has been taught into a tradition that has a historical connection to the past and a continuity along with other bodies in society. And that it not only occurs in ballet, you see it. This continuity of humanity moving together, you see it in the athletic parades. It's part of the physical culture. It does not only happen in the enclave of theater, stage dance, but it is the poetry of the communist body, of the social body. So these images of girls are the individual girls of the Komsomol, or you know, they're friends, they live together, but at the same time they represent the Soviet man. Yeah, how a body is happy, healthy, disciplined in a way, yeah, disciplined, and beautiful. So that has universal poetry. But somehow people get blind to it because of the meaning that they see imposed on it. But they would be perfectly able to recognize this formation as something poetic, beautiful, feminist, somewhere else. So these parades, these social symphonies of plastic imagery, are very much like ballet, and they're in dialogue with ballet. I don't see them as something separate. And they're polyphonic ensembles which juxtapose different voices, the different individual voices of the people, in the core, in the body of the Soviet Union. In fact, classicism and socialist realism, that's the stage, a stage. So you see it on the streets, Mayakovsky said, let our, the streets be our canvases, be our stages, and you also see it on the stage. So these formations, this plastic imagery. So classicism, that comes from ballet, and socialist realism are completely compatible. And so to be puzzled over how a highly codified art form was able to express socialist realism means that one is completely unable to grasp realism as a material representation of humanity. That's my conclusion. One must remember that ballet itself evolved from pure, empty, ornamental use in the courts to a content-rich art form that is staged and communicates a story, like in theater and in drama. This is a school in Moscow in 1941, where this is called a chain movement. And it teaches people to move together like a corps de ballet, like a body, like one body. Still, when you teach ballet today, the Russian style, you say you have to breathe as one body. And you do a range of exercises that will teach people to do that. And we see it in spectacles in North Korea, the same thing. Something to do with the communist body and how it moves in sync together to express a meaning that is beyond the individual, that transcends the individual, but comes through the individual in connection with others. So one must remember that ballet had this ornamental use and now communicates a message. And what some people are at pains to fathom is that ballet as art can have a social mission, and that socialist realism exists at war as a renunciation of Western modernism. It's basically they are fighting. So their denial sometimes is because they feel threatened by it, because Western formalism and Western modernism believes that its capitalist production, it's abstracted from ideology. They see themselves as free. Nothing oppresses them. Nothing makes them do what they're doing. It's their own autonomous genius. Where in fact, there is no artistic abstraction in capitalism. It is based on superstructure. They just follow the rules. And the rules are set by the capitalist system. Here is another photograph. That's from a school. So we are. This is a real cultural trickling down effect from what we see on stage to what we see in the parades, what we see taught at schools. These are school children. I mean, it's precious. Imagine, I'm doing this effort, I'm teaching ballet at schools, in after-school clubs in this country. And the kids, they don't get any opportunity to move together in a disciplined way that also gives them pleasure. And back then in Soviet times, this was in 1931, it was given to the people in all schools. It was common practice to learn that. Okay, so this is a beautiful stage production at the Bolshoi, 1941, of, can you guess, Shakespeare, Romeo and Juliet. Lavish production, amazing scenery, stages, chandeliers, yes. And this is the choreographer there, Zakharov, is someone I discovered was a great defender of drum ballet during the de-Stalinization. And let's see what he talked about. He wrote a book, first of all, The Art of the Choreographer. And he was the main practical theoretician of drum ballet. And repeatedly warned against seeing classical dance technique as a goal in itself. And a lot of people resisted that. Here is an amazing choreographer like Vaganova, who can talk about the art of choreography, but saying this is not the goal, it should not be a goal in itself. Zakharov wrote that the choreographer should only use those movements of classical dance which corresponded to the plot of the specific ballet in question. This is the art of choreography, and non-Soviet choreographers, who are good choreographers, like Fokin, for example, are praised in the West for creating ballets that had, that didn't have this typical feeling of ballet move that you would see in any ballet, irrespective of whether the ballet was set in the 19th century or in the 17th century, or it tells a story about metaphysical creatures, that they would all have the same movement. But choreographic innovators like Zakharov, like Fokin in France, who was also Russian but immigrated there, they made movement specific to the era that was portrayed. So realistic movement. So where they're not using the five positions of the feet that were balletic, but made sure that the movement corresponded to the meaning of the specific message that was the intention of portray on stage. So that ballet is not an ossified repetition of steps and combinations. So that was before socialist realism became state policy. But when it became state policy, instead of praising it, like they did in the West, as innovation, they saw it as imposition, which I find interesting. Zakharov condemned abstract classical choreography that was not pushing forward the plot, saying that it was mindless after-dinner entertainment. So we're going back to the bourgeois world if you do that. And declared that Soviet ballet had parted with this tradition for good. To have a meaning, so he defended the meaningful plot. To have a meaningful plot recognizable by the audience, accessible, understood, able to move, and relatable to them, expanded the scope of ballet's expressiveness. Zakharov showed that there is no pure dance, but dance needs to be consciously aware of the reality it refers to. And he called critics who supported the experiments of formalist choreographers, he called them cosmopolitans. Back in the 30s, he called them cosmopolitans devoid of any feeling of patriotism. I find that very interesting and a very political position to have. According to Zakharov, the ballet formalists had rejected the necessity of creative links between ballet and the dramatic theater, insisting instead that ballet was a unique art. So they were defending their own uniqueness. And that was not going to be restricted in any way, but had to be developed according to its own laws. So you see, when you start saying that I don't want to serve a plot, what my art form is unique. It has its own laws. You become a cosmopolitan. You become a cosmopolitan. You see, you belong to the ballet land, the ballet world. You're a citizen of the ballet world. So proponents of choreographic symphonism, which I explained is this defense of abstract ballet as something poetic that follows the music but doesn't have a concrete meaning to communicate, they argued that similar to symphonic music, the expressive strength of classical dance lay not in the representation of concrete situations, but in its capacity to operate on a level of poetic, non-verbal generalization. And that's why we should aim at. This generalization moves people, they say, in a better way than a communist message ever will. Okay, they consider drum ballet to be too didactic. Art that is didactic. The truth is that drum ballet was able to represent human activities, stories, and feelings precisely through poetic nonverbal conventions. Because how else you, I mean, if I dance on ballet, I'm using my body, not using my voice. How can I be didactic? They feel threatened by this plot. And hence they see a message that denies them, and they oppose it. They deny its very poetry. They had difficulty accepting that no artistic law should function independently of the laws of the proletarian dictatorship, because that was the society that gave birth to it. So it could not have laws that are unique and pertain only to it. It had to abide by the laws of the society that funded it, gave birth to it, and sustained it. So, with the death of Stalin, we have socialist realism for cultural production being heavily debated, denied, degraded, caricatured all the people involved in it. And Stalin knew it. I think all these efforts, the Zhdanov doctrine, the anti-formalist campaign, occurred because these forces, these people were already there, and it was a class warfare, and they were ready to pounce, and they did when Stalin died. Reactionaries, even to this day, present this as a purely aesthetic debate. They say, don't politicize it. Don't you understand? It's only about how we portray movement, how we can better our art. But no, it is a political debate. Do you recognize that this has different... I'm always interested in asking someone who is not versed in ballet the way I am, except for this being obviously not black and white and contemporary looking. Do you realize some difference in the quality from the photos that I've been showing you? This is a Western formalist, stiff, yes. It is the kind of artistry they defend as being pure, abstract, universalizing. That doesn't say something specific, but has a certain geometry. But ballet already has. It's all about symmetry. But the quality here, this is by choreographer Georges Balanchine, was also Russian, went to the West, became the founder of the New York Ballet. After the de-Stalinization, when all the drum ballet people were pushed to the side as being restrictors and imposers on the art of ballet, we had the imitation of the Western formalism. So we had this imitation of the Balanchine style. And we had defections. We had defections because freedom of the artist had to come first. Nureyev, Makarova, Baryshnikov, all these dancers were defected to the West. But back in 1960, again, the battle was still ongoing. And there was another choreographer, Leonid Lavrovsky, choreographer of the Soviet drum ballet, the classic Romeo and Juliet, who gave the keynote address at a meeting of choreographers. In an effort to defend the tenets of drum ballet, Lavrovsky argued against the so-called theory of the world of agitated feeling. There was this theory that ballet had to be about emotions, art should be about agitated feeling that should be portrayed in a pure form. And he attacked a choreographer called Yuri Grigorovich, who became very famous for his Spartacus. You might have seen it. Spartacus. Grigorovich is the choreographer of Spartacus. And Spartacus has been touring in the 60s, the 70s, the 80s. I saw it as a child, late 80s, in Herodus Atticus in Athens, the ancient amphitheater, as a pure cultural export of the Soviet Union. Spartacus. But the choreographer Grigorovich was heavily criticized by people like Lavrovsky for using formalism, symphonism, making the music express, the body express the music. Even if Spartacus tells a story, he would have an issue with the formal qualities that were a mimetism of Balanchinian style that was coming from the West. So they continued to tell stories, they continued to have dramatic plots, but the way they served them was not socialist realism. And that for some choreographers, like Lavrovsky, was not fulfilling the aim of the Soviet ballet. Lavrovsky said, nothing we should portray should be inspired by this theory of the world of agitated feeling, because that's hollow. It's a hollow topic. And Lavrovsky contrasted Soviet ballet's elevation. He said, we have elevated ballet to this form, and now you want to bring us back to formalism. We had an art form rich in content, and you want to bring back a pointless demonstration of technique. Lavrovsky stated that the champions of this danciness had a confederate in the West. That was Georges Balanchine, who led a technically accomplished company which didn't dance music. It wasn't even music, Lavrovsky said. he made the criticism of Balanchine, but naked rhythm without content. In his concluding remarks to the conference of the choreographers at the end of, 1960, Lavrovsky stated that there was a struggle between Western formalism and Soviet ideology. And he said, we will either defend Soviet ideology or we will become Western formalists. And then an important art director and dancer himself, Sergeyev, agreed with him and stated that in the ideological struggle with the West, it was especially important to keep the Soviet Union's ideological weapons in order. He was worried that some choreographers displayed modernist tendencies, surrendering themselves to bourgeois aesthetics. He actually said this in the conference. He declared that he was disturbed by the theories put forth at the conference about agitated feeling, which tried to rally everyone around this idea. The world of emotions, the world of abstract images, devoid of biographical particulars and profession. And along the similar veins, Zakharov, Lavrovsky, Sergeyev, the three of them declared that two currents were outlined in this conference. One defends realism in the art of dance, the other anti-realistic tendencies that are adversarial to us. After all, the most agitated feelings, if they are separated from ideas, lead to a completely incorrect abstract conception, the world in general. And that cannot be Soviet ideology. Unfortunately, with the thaw, all these ideas of dance's primacy was restored. That was a ballet that you might have heard of. It's called The Bolt. And it's the music is by Shostakovich. This ballet, when you might come across a dance historian, you talk about Soviet Union, they say, but they censored Shostakovich's ballet, The Bolt. They censored his golden age. That bureaucracy had a way of making sure that these innovations that were, yes, serving a social aim, but in using modern elements, that they were pulled down. This is what you get. The first thing they say to you, but what ballet are you looking at when you're studying Soviet ballet? Why don't you look at Shostakovich? Okay, yes, okay. And then, so I looked at Shostakovich and I realized that a lot of those ballets were pulled down for other reasons. Problems in choreography, because when you innovate, you create something modern, it's more difficult for the dancers to get used to your new dance lexicon. So sometimes it was the dancers themselves boycotting, not wanting to dance. Or there were other problems in production that had nothing to do with bureaucracy. But of course, because those productions were pulled down, they attributed to some conspiracy against the freedom of the artist. Bolt tells the story of a worker who wants to make the factory stop, to sabotage it. Sabotage the production. So he puts a bolt that makes the machine break. But then at the end of the ballet, we have a restoration of the production and the traitor is punished. That's the story of ballet. So it is a meaning, it has a meaning, it has a message. But the way it was portrayed was had problems. Even though it was the music by Shostakovich, a great Lyupukov choreographer, it didn't work. There were different efforts with various degrees of success. They were pulled down because of problems associated with the quality of the choreography or the plot that was not understood by the audience. The audience would yawn, would not get it. Therefore, the production was not successful. And it had nothing to do with bureaucratic interference, that. Some experimentalist productions of the 1920s that are now praised as the elements that were suppressed and we have to look at, had the audience falling asleep in the auditorium. And it was the audience's reaction that mattered, not the innovation of Shostakovich, however brilliant he was. Some were acceptable in aiding in the struggle, and that was the aim. How what you create is helpful to people in their struggle. And it is the people who will decide. politics and culture as one. And that's another photograph from the Bolt, because it did get staged. It was staged, but it had problems, so it had to stop. And now Bolshoi and Kirov have revived it. And there is all this talk about why it was suppressed and now it has to come back. So what is a socialist plot, a socialist realist plot? Is to have a hero, like in Bolt, the person who saves the factory, class enemies, a disciple, someone who doesn't know anything about class consciousness, but through the plot becomes more aware, and moves from spontaneity to consciousness. So the introduction of the stage, the introduction of character is someone who is moved by emotion, but gradually through the story becomes consciousness of struggle. And the ballet that I think encapsulates this perfectly is The Red Poppy. The Red Poppy was staged, first staged in 1927. The Bolshoi was a production of the Bolshoi with beautiful music by Lier and choreography by Tikhomirov. And it portrays Soviet sailors in a Chinese port. And that was an up-to-date, a minute headline back then. There was an incident where a Soviet ship was in Canton and it was observed by local people working for the colonialists. So it referred to a real event. And it has a Chinese setting that provides color and character dances, but the dance movements were traditional, were balletic, so they were wearing point shoes. You see this movement called arabesque. But Tikhomirov, the choreographer, brings in a very famous tune, a very famous street song that you might know, the Yablochko. It's the dance of the sailors, I'm going to show you later. And he had the orchestra of the Bolshoi refusing to play a street song. They said, look, we are trained classical symphonic artists here, musicians, and you are asking us to play a street song. That's vulgar. But then they saw the merits of including that, and that has become an iconic moment of Soviet ballet that includes an element of topicality, of real folk dancing. So that is Lepeshinskaya, Olga Lepeshinskaya. I'm going to talk to you about her. That's her. So the plot, to give you an idea of how we move from spontaneity to consciousness, how we have class enemies, how we have a Soviet hero. I'm going to read you the plot. A Soviet ship moors on the shores of China. Dark forces try by bribery or deceit, these are the class enemies, to weaken the vigilance of the Soviet guards and seize the ship. To this end, the hetera, the palanquin, the dancer of the port, enters, known as the Red Poppy. She's the Red Poppy. She is an elemental force. All the hopes of a band of evil-minded pirates that want to win over the captain are pinned on her, so she has to seduce him. In the ballet, there is an opium den, a palace of the governor, etc. And the most interesting characters are Tao Hao, the dancer, and her father, who is a worker with no class consciousness. And then you have the Chinese coolies who instinctively sense that the Soviet sailors are their friends. The most enthralling moment of the ballet occurs when the hetera of the port tries through female wiles to lure the captain into betrayal, but he firm and unbending and true to his ideology, does not give in. This causes an astonishment to the father of the hetera, who stands nearby, and his class consciousness is awakened. This is a turning point. Class consciousness awakens them both. At the decisive moment, Tao Hao sacrifices herself, saves the steamship, which safely sails to sea, to the strains of the Internationale and the enthusiasm of the coolies. And we had 400 people storming the stage. We had a real battleship, Soviet battleship, on the stage, and 400 coolies raising the dead body of Tao Hao, who is passing them the red poppy. It's a symbol of resistance, all to the sounds of the Internationale. So we have portrayal of the masses, portrayal of the hero, the class enemies, the disciple, which is the red poppy, who moves from spontaneity to class consciousness. That's a socialist ballet. Another socialist ballet is The Flames of Paris, which was staged in 1932, and the choreographer is called Vainonen. And this ballet also exhibits a clear sense of time and place, and that is revolutionary France of 1792. It has a lavish use of folk motifs, dances from different parts of France. And even though it's not based on a contemporary theme, that, like we saw in The Red Poppy, it is comprehensible to the people who saw it because it reflects the spirit of the times, revolutionary France, that inspires the people in their own struggle. The theme is romantic heroic. There is love, there is a hero, there is death. And we have a rehabilitation of romanticism in that ballet. And at the time that this was shown, there was criticism in the press of very subtle, very high, very elevated discourse that debated on whether art was justified in anticipating in dreams a reality, or whether it should reject all idealistic tendencies and stick to actuality. And I was reading a range of literature, critical literature, from a broad basis of Marxism and dialectical materialism written at the time, so 1932, and you see the quality of the culture produced, not just by what was produced, by the level of criticism, of course. And writing on the question of the difference between dreams and reality, one critic, Pisarev, said the following: "There are differences and differences. My dreams may run ahead of the natural progress of events, or may fly off at a tangent in a direction to which no natural progress of events, or which no natural progress of events will ever proceed. In the first case, the dream will not cause any harm. It may support and strengthen the efforts of toiling humanity. Divergence between dreams and reality cause no harm if only the person dreaming them believes seriously in his dreams. If he attentively observes life, compares his observations with the airy castles he builds, and if, generally speaking, he works conscientiously for the achievements of his fantasies. If there is some connection between dreams and life, then all is well." He said that based on this ballet, that the romanticism of the ballet was still pertaining to the struggle. So it was not bourgeois. So both approaches, the heroic and romantic and the historical, meet at the Flames of Paris. And this is the finale, where the hero dies, carrying the flag. The liberation of the oppressed, that is, class warfare, carried out by the French people during the revolution, that awakens the revolutionary fervor of the audience. Like in the finale of The Red Poppy, here also we have 500 people on stage. And that creates a genuine Soviet spectacle that raises the morale of the people. And to achieve this elevation of the morale of the people, we had reworkings of the Swan Lake. I don't know if you know the plot. There is a princess that falls under a spell of the magician, and she's turned into a swan. A prince falls in love with a princess. The only way to save her and return her to her human form is to love her and to marry her. But the magician deceives him, seduces him by creating an image of someone who looks like the swan princess, but she's not. She's just an evil seductress. The prince falls under her spell. The swan princess falls into the lake to die, but he goes after her, so sacrificing himself, and the sacrifice saves her. That's the original ballet. But this had to be reworked to get rid of the mysticism. And who was it who reworked it? The plot? It was Maxim Gorky. So he turned this based on a novel that he had written, based on a critique of a Prussian depressive prince who cannot see reality, and he falls in love with a swan. And Rothbard, who is the magician, is basically his father, his alter ego. And at the end, he dies. And his body is being carried by black swans. So they get their comeuppance. So it's a complete reworking of the plot. And so those ballets were really revolutionized to get rid of their mysticism. Vaganova herself spoke out for modernizing the classics, but she opposed throwing the baby out with the bathwater, she said. Preservation is equivalent to ossification, and she encouraged all the young choreographers of the time to work on those ballets without taboo, you know, to really change the plot. That's The Swan Lake with Galina Ulanova in 1930. Another ballet that has also that's based on a piece of literature was Lorenzia, by Chabukyani, an amazing Georgian choreographer, that was choreographed in 1939. You see Sergeyev and Natalia Dudiskaya, and it's based on Lupe de Vega's Fuente over Huna. It's a story again about a people's uprising, rebellion in a Spanish village. But it is dependent on the knowledge of the play. But that play was quite well known at the time. Critics said it had an instinctive approach to the dance, and they criticized him as impulsive and untutored in his poetry. Needed the addition of a certain intellectual knowledge before it could realize its potential. So you see the level of criticism that also helps the artist self-criticize. The level of the criticism, we don't see it in our times. It was really helpful to the artist. So this untutored poetry, how beautifully put, that needs intellectual knowledge before it can realize its potential. How nurturing to the artist. And Chabukyani went on to become a great choreographer. So it was not the kind of criticism that would destroy you. It was the kind of criticism that would nurture you. And now, because I'm going to close, with Olga Lepeshinskaya, a communist ballerina to the end of her life, member of the Communist Party. Olga Lepeshinskaya, this is a portrait painted by Gerasimov, socialist-realist painter. She's a celebrated ballerina. She's not very well known in the West, not as Galina Ulanova, certainly not as the reactionary Maya Plisetskaya, who went on after the death of Stalin to say how much she suffered under the suppressive regime and all these things. That's why she's very famous in the West. And we don't know much about Lepeshinskaya, who was born in Kiev in a noble family. Her grandfather was participated in Narodnaya Volya. He was a socialist revolutionary. And her father was a civil engineer. And she had a very boyish, she represents her body. Her temperament is something that has been lost to ballerinas of this age. She was very, very dynamic, so very athletic. So the bodies that you see in the parades and Lepeshinskaya on stage is a very youthful, very effervescent, very, very healthy body. But at the same time, it is not what we see, this competitive machine body, like robotic body that we see in dancers today. So she was seen as very talented, spotted as very talented, and her mother was told to take her it's not an audition, is basically you took children from all walks of life to be seen by experts. And even that in the West, they see as something like they were checking their torsos, they were making them, they portrayed as a violence against children, that they were measuring them, nothing of the sort. All they did is they had to see the body to see if it had the ability to train for ballet, if it had certain symmetry of the certain flexibility, or it could be channeled to other sports or to folk dance. All they did is to nurture the right people for the right thing. The selection was not in any way, it was wise, because they knew what the demands were on the young body. And now this has come back also. They don't longer see, they see it as scientific. They start to recognize that there was a reason why you had to see which body is appropriate for which dance form. So she was taken for an audition, and they said, you're not for ballet. But you can, we can allow you to come to the school and study choreography, but you're not going to become a ballerina. But she persisted, she excelled, and she was the very first ballerina who performed on the stage of the Bolshoi at the age of 10, very young. She created many new ballets that she were created for her. That is her, the year she graduated from the Bolshoi. She hated dancing Swan Lake, the Odette. She was very self-critical. She did not find that she had those qualities that would allow her to merge with the imagery of the swan. Despite that, she danced the Swan Lake, but she never liked it. And it was in one of these performances that in the 1940s, she was seen by Stalin. Stalin really loved watching Olga Lepeshinskaya dance. Was not the only artist. There is a lot of literature that you find that they try to portray this as an affair. There is a lot of that. There is no historical evidence of this being something beyond honoring an artist. But they say all sorts of things, you know, to tarnish the memory of Stalin and of this great ballerina. The truth is that this ballerina that you see performing here during the Great Patriotic War under the portrait of Stalin, she was one of the first laureates and one of the first to be awarded the Stalin Prize 4 times for her portrayal of dance characters on stage. And at the beginning of the war, Olga was a member of the Komsomol. She ran the Komsomol District Committee. And she asked herself, she volunteered to be sent to the front. And she perfectly passed all the standards and received the badge of the Voroshilovsky shooter. That's not very common in the dance world, but there she is, Olga Lepeshinskaya. But she was advised to go to do a nurse's courses, but of course, you know, she didn't. She wanted to go to the front and dance as a ballerina. So they told her, you will help in this way by continuing to dance for the troops. There she is, an image of a lady artist of the times. See how emancipated, driving her own car down Gorky Street. You know, we don't get to see images of those times and how artists were received by the audience, how they were honored by the state, what lifestyles they led. We see images like that in the West, but we don't really see this. So I thought it's an important image to show how emancipated, how liberated. A woman who didn't have kids, had 3 husbands, worked all her life, went to the front, all these things that we don't hear about. And this is the apartment that she used to live in, the Gorky Street. And this is called the building under the skirt. It's not her, but she lived there. So there is anecdotal evidence that she had, that people thought that this is Lepeshinskaya because she lived there, and that she had a special connection to the statue. And during the raids and the bombardment, someone was calling to ask if Lepeshinskaya is fine, you know, if the building of Lepeshinskaya, if the statue was fine. It was actually pulled down after the death of Stalin, and it coincided with Lepeshinskaya losing her 3rd husband and going blind. She went blind from the shock. So she said that she fell at the same time I did. And it's very interesting. We were researching recently, and I think they are going to restore the Stalin statue in Moscow. There is a tendency to bring back the statues. So I'm finishing by saying that Lepeshinskaya, People's Artist of the USSR, four times laureate of the state Stalin Prizes. She was honored by Putin in 2008, before she died. And she remained a communist until the end. My conclusion is that socialist-realist ballet is far from a monolithic doctrine. It has taken many forms, has affected all aspects of physical culture in the USSR, and it is synonymous to creative death and accountability towards the society it serves. It gave rise to amateur art in the USSR, not only professional. Many houses and palaces of culture had their own symphony orchestras, where workers, engineers, collective farmers, and students appeared as cellists, and they did the Swan Lake, amateur troupes that put up really difficult productions, such as the Red Poppy that you saw. And those are some images of the amateur ballerinas that we had. Firmly based on the great and uninterrupted traditions of the past, drawing sustenance from 160 million people, having at its command an unlimited income from the state, fed by schools which produced a galaxy of unrivaled dancers, the Soviet ballet is incomparable, a glory to the nation, the people, and the age that produced it.